I've only added four or five supporting slides because one of the risks of a demo about automation is that there are many things that happen very quickly and say ta-da, it's finished and doesn't make any sense if you do not understand really the complexity of what is going on behind these things. Okay, so I think it's interesting first to recap what is happening in the demo in slow motion, explain it, and then later on explaining how it goes. So this is a part of a joint activity between two service providers, I mean, Telenor and Telefonica. So this is not just, not representing only the work of the Telefonica team, that of course I am, but also the work and the excellent collaboration that we had with Telenor. That if you want to do something about the issues, pain points, we've heard about pain points this morning, and I think it's quite popular to some extent, right? But I mean, but the problem with pain points is that there may be legitimate pain points. They can be pain points that are in have some solutions or even workarounds, or cannot be even a point, right? And they think that the best way to address issues is precisely to try to face them in practice, and engage in and with those who are providing the technologies to try to find a solution that we've been discussing. And actually, I'm trying to explain this because this is the context that there's some, sometimes it's less risky to show red flags about things that do not go well, and it's less popular to explain things that go well. And I think that, I mean, we should change the ship a little bit, I totally agree with the point that we need to focus on what's not going well. And the first step to address anything that is not going well is identifying it properly and trying to find what are the alternatives. Okay. So that said, I think that, I mean, if I can summarize what I've just said, it's in one sentence. I mean, the theory works pretty well. The practice does not work that well. And if you are a theorist, you will always stay in the theory. And maybe echoing some issues that we've heard about the theory. And that's it. There's no potential to move on at all. So the practice is a call of action. And it's an active call of action. Okay, and it demands something from you. That is identifying correctly problems. We have seen today an excellent exercise of spending based on the experience of identifying the problems that probably everyone knew that they existed, but no one had spent sufficient time to put them together in a presentation. So that is helping, right? And I think that the practice is what gives you, as the scientific method suggests this. I mean, you have some hypotheses, but then you need to validate it by experimentation and iterate over them, right? That said, what we were doing with Telenor, it's a journey that we started 6 months ago, is trying to validate main 5G concepts, particularly some of the ones that seem fuzzy and with a lot of trouble behind them, in a context where we were adding some restrictions. One is that we wanted to make sure that they were significant so we could have different type of slices that, and something that we could easily replicate. So that means that we were creating the stamp and could be validated by anyone, right? So we're not just that we were saying so, it's that it could be done. And also that we were using commercial products, okay? So that those are restrictions because when you are talking about 5G, you're hearing about many things that might possibly be done, but the reality is much humbler, right? So the idea, as I said, is to deploy 2 slices at least, okay? With some input parameters, because what you need is to feed with some different restrictions, different type of configurations, so you don't need to recreate your template for the slices. That was one primary condition. And then we wanted to operate then later on with day two. Okay? Day two, there is a short, this short way of saying for the rest of their lifetime. Okay? And so in terms of the deployment, what you'll see is that, I mean, each slices model has a set of network services. As I was commenting the other day, I mean, a network service, I mean, in the constructs of 3GPP, actually there's a concept that is a network slice subnet that maps one-to-one, if you keep reading further, to one network service, for the concept to a network service. Okay? So we were taking that as granted, okay, and what we'll see is that we are providing input parameters to determine the type of slice, so we are not changing the template, we are parametrizing at the time of instantiation, and we are experimenting also with some different type of combination of quality. Not all of them are efficiently enforced in all the technologies, so you might have uneven results in different radios, etc., but from the point of configuration, that is what is being demonstrated. I mean, it's totally consistent across different radios. Okay. We have two slides, but they have some network service, not some network slice subnets. To make this more interesting, you need to deal with shared subnets. There are subsets of your network that need to be shared between different slices, and so others that are dedicated. Okay. And that is a challenge because you are asking your orchestration engine to determine which networks, existing network services, based on an initial template, you need to determine which network services already have been instantiated and are valid for you. So instead of instantiating again a new network service, it takes over that other network service and reconfigures accordingly without breaking the previous configuration. Okay, that is the size of the challenge. Okay. And of course, an initial configuration can be done in the second one, and then we'll see in day two some operations as well. Okay. So we'll do something practical with the slices. Okay. Well, there were some participants in this POC besides Telenor and Telefonica, so we could guarantee that all the components used in the POC were commercial, okay? And we had their supporting case that we had some unexpected result or something went wrong with the hardware, I don't know. So it's, and also an excellent support from Intel, okay? In case that something went wrong even with the chips. So we were in the safe side. So what we'll do in practice, and this is not what you'll see later on, so that's why I'm trying to keep it conceptual yet, is that first we will request to the system that, if you remember from yesterday's presentation, OSM provides networks as a service, is what it does. Okay, so what we'll be doing is requesting in a network as a service and a slice for enhanced mobile broadband. That is what we have. We have a blob. From the perspective of the user, you have an object that is that slice. Okay, but what happens inside is more interesting, and I think that and what happens is that you have different subnets that are mapped to slices. I mean, one is the RAN, obviously. Other is the core. Actually, this core, I mean, is artificially compacted in the picture, but it doesn't look like that. I mean, it's split between, it has a gateway, it has its HSS, it has MME, it's more complex, but I mean in order to facilitate the picture is picture like a single box, but you'll see shortly that it's not like that, okay? And then we, in order to make things even more interesting, we've added a PCRF, okay? And you'll see that there's a lot of networks that have been created in the middle that eventually will need to be used, okay? So that's part of the fun. And later on, we'll request to the system, again, this is user's perspective, we'll request another slice that is something that is happening in the network with other characteristics, this ultra reliable low latency. Okay? What is happening underneath is that we'll need to recognize that all this existed and add the delta. Reconfigure what exists without breaking anything another delta. Okay, which in this case is a happy gateway. Okay, we are working in this just to be, to provide all the details of what we are doing here. I mean, we are working in a ED core configuration, okay, which is the most reliable configuration for 5G-like environments with cores that are not 5G cores yet, but are EPC plus, okay. So this is actually this is more challenging from the perspective of orchestration. So if we were going to reconfigure everything in the same change over and over, I mean, it would be much simpler. But here, it seems, I mean, the limitations of the BNFs will give us more visibility on what are the actual things that you can do. Okay, and there are some PNFs. I mean, the Oracle PCRF is a physical network function. Okay, in this case. Just for the fun of it, I mean, because it's possible to do it as a virtual network function, as maybe many of you know, okay? So it's not a limitation of Oracle's PSRF, it's simply that we wanted to make it interesting, okay? So this is the full picture. What is going on underneath is all this, okay? So demo time. In the event in Madrid, we were doing this live. I think that it is way more interesting, but the setup of having a nested VPN from here, even this morning we were struggling to have a VGA cable here, right? So I think that. But if some of you are interested in seeing this demo live, in two weeks we have a Hackfest here in the Bay Area, so it would be possible to stop. Change parameters with you, etc., etc. Anyway, so as I was saying, this is how it looks like from the user perspective. We are using the UI. Okay, we are logging in. Okay, if you remember from the other day, the first thing is to load the model. So that's what we are doing. Here we have, I don't know if at this distance, I'm sorry for the resolution, because it's very tiny and everything. But here are the packages of the BNFs. I mean, this is obviously they've gone through some validation that we are skipping here. I mean, we are testing them in isolation to see that they work as they are expected. Okay, that's happened. And the thing is that from the operational perspective, from our business units will use it, is that they will simply load them, okay? So this step is, this is just aesthetics, just drag and drop in the GUI of OSM, but in the CLI is another procedure, but it's pretty much it, okay? So we are adding to a catalog the BNFs that I've mentioned before, okay?
BNFs, right?
No, packages. But the whole thing that we were discussing yesterday, the structure, is not particularly challenging, to be honest. The interesting is what comes inside the Solve4 package, okay? So the thing is that, once that you have the packages, you can also onboard the packages of the definition of the network service that is on us. We are the service provider, so we have validated some environments, at least in one local central location, where we are showing, those subnets, how they should look like. Okay, so this is what we are loading now. Okay, so these are the network services that in case play the role of network subnets, a la 3GPP. Okay, well, this part is okay. And then, interesting, we are adding a network slide template, which is a particular construct from the EPP to define an slice. In this case, we are defining this only one template, and you'll see why in a minute, because we are trying to create both slides, in spite of what you've seen that we are calculating deltas, are the same. So if I had reversed the order of instantiation, and I've started by ultra-reliable low latency first, it should create the whole thing, right? So, this is a traffic generator that we are using. So at this point, we don't have a network, okay? So if we attach it one of the ends, both ends actually, we don't have it. Well, actually, in this case, what we are showing here is the case where the traffic generator is only attached on one end, and we are in one of the subnets we have attached a web server, okay? But just to make sure that in GI we have something that is responding and is more realistic, okay? Okay, anyway, details that do not change the concept of the demo anyway. Okay, so we didn't have a network at this point. We only have templates, okay? Now is where we are instantiating the network slice. I'll post it here. So what we are saying is, look, I want to request you to instantiate this template for network slice and telling you in which location, actually, where I'm really curious about the issues that were commented before about the edge scenarios, because this is essentially an edge scenario. Okay, so maybe it's a matter of configuration or something that is what you are wondering. So maybe we can take it offline later. But essentially what we've done, is that we are using several data centers that could be hundreds, okay? As a target, actually, something that happens behind the scenes is that we can split the network server. And actually, what is happening by configuration is that we are splitting it into two small data centers in a lab location, because not all the components fitted in the same place, so we could separate them and nothing happens. I mean, you can tell whether they are together or separated geographically, okay? Anyway, so the thing is that the subnets are here, and now we are in the process that they are being configured. I mean, they are instantiated. The instantiation is relatively fast, but now they are popping up some of the VMs. You see them in the different, this is Horizon, a snapshot that is of what is going on in Horizon that is overimposed, okay, so you see that what is going on there. I mean, it's more interesting in a live demo, I know, but anyway, I think that you get the point, okay? So the thing is that once that they are instantiated, we are also configuring and adding all this, the zero, of course, that is easy, but also the day one. I mean, now only one subnet is about to be, now that is ready, all the subnets are ready, okay? So now we have the slice ready for its use, and all the VNFs in each of the slices and each of the subnets of, I mean, have been conveniently configured. So the you can see, I mean, actually the parameters that have been passed, and you have even the story of actions. It's more interesting when we run a couple of day two operations. You will keep the story of all the operations that have been run in each of the components and the slices, so you can recreate from scratch and bring them to the same state if needed. I mean, okay, so that is interesting. Hopefully, it's better that you don't ever need it, but but sometimes you can use it. Okay, and this is a way of performing actions. Okay, so I mean, as I said, I mean you can call some actions of high level, so that are percolated across all the components and that you creating a transaction and unique configuration, okay? So this is what is happening here. What we are defining an APN, because right now we have a slice, but it's not yet usable. I mean, it could be. I mean, nothing would prevent us to add this call in the day one operation and have it still available as a day two, but I mean, this makes the demo more interesting, okay? But in terms of operation, it doesn't make sense to split it in two steps, okay? So we are triggering that operation of creating an APN with some addressing and adding some. So here it is, okay? So, and the addressing is correct, apparently. Okay. Is it still? Ah, yeah, it was blinking in my screen, sorry. Okay, and all the actions of configuration have happened already. So the APN in this case only touches on one of the components, but I mean, this is going too fast, sorry. Okay, so it's touching the EPC in this case, okay. Okay, which is the subnet of the EPC, okay. So now we can use another day two primitive. We can add some mobile phones, okay, some SIM to this APN and add them. So we have added ones, and we'll keep use the same primitive, and we'll edit and add another number, consecutive number here, okay, for demo purposes, and that's it. And then now we can emulate those users with those SIMs, and you'll see that we'll get the traffic, and we can be successful. Okay, it takes some time, hopefully, crossing the fingers. Yeah, okay. Okay, so go through. So they have traffic, they can request web pages, etc. Okay. Okay, and we are getting this. You are running a speed test. And discounting all the effects that you have in your interconnection in a lab, etc., etc. Oh, sorry, you can have standard mobile broadband. In practice, you need to repeat this test several times because you might have connection in your internet access in the lab. You might have a congestion, right? So, but anyway, but in clean conditions, it works as expected, as not a lab but a real network. Something that we can do is that we can instantiate again with parameters for ultra reliable low latency. In this case, this is a bit of a trick for demonstration, okay? So I'm being totally honest with you. The way that we are doing this in practice and modeling this in practice is separating the different parameters, because there's no an obvious definition of ultra-reliable low latency with a given set of parameters, right? We are simplifying it, so we do not need to fill in a number of weird parameters. This is mapped in the primitive inside the charm. So, but anyway, the process is totally the same, but this makes the explanation simpler, and you don't need to fill in 100 parameters, okay? But in realistic conditions, it would be probably advisable, okay? So we are instantiating the subnets and the BNFs that are missing, okay? The delta that I mentioned, okay? So we are in that process. Ah, okay, it's working. Okay, now we are finishing the configuration of one of them. 3, 2, 1, okay. Okay, it's there, okay. So now the new slice is available. We'll plug our traffic generator. In this case, I'm skipping some steps. Okay, and now I can attach it. No issues. Okay, and all the traffic is going. The traffic is going. It goes without saying, but now it's going through their own P gateway. So that means that we can redirect that traffic differently, etc., etc. And if you run the speed test, you get less bandwidth but more reliable latency because you are not have all the penalty in the radio. Okay. So that is what we are seeing. So as a recap, here is the cursor. As a recap, what we've seen, and I know that demos of automation, as I warn you, are a bit messy because there are many things going on, and they happen faster than you can assimilate. So hopefully, I've done my best to tell you what was happening before, so you were warned. I've stopped it, so it was slower, and now we can recap in case that some points were not got. Okay, so this is for facilitating. We are talking more than about a mobile technology, we are talking about a new management technique. The slice is just a construct for a network as a service, more sophisticated than the network service because it allows you to share pre-existing instances, which is a challenge, but also makes it even more powerful. Okay, and inside you need to determine whether you want to use an slide or a vanilla network service, depending on your needs, so you are not overcomplicating anything. There are no fundamental differences in this setup, as you have seen, between a BNF or a physical network function. Actually, there's nothing much difference, as you have seen. You are not mandating any specific protocol, as you have seen, in configuration, because each of the components add their own procedure for configuration. We have not even mentioned what technologies of the beams were there, okay? Even there's one version that was run in the zero touch automation in Madrid, smaller, running some components that actually part of the DNS resolution and all the like in AWS. So, it's and running it again in an open stack, etc. So it's not, from the perspective of the way of using it, is not particularly different, okay? And of course, something that is a must here and is something that we are realizing, that the vendors should have a clear understanding of how their BNF works, which means what are the, how to inject some parameters so we can particularize it, so they are not a rock that it has everything pre-configured, or I do not have any mean to inject new configurations. I mean, obviously, there are very basic things. As a very minimum, we are not, something that we are saying, and anyone who is attending the OSM workshops, is that it's not about the language that you're using to describe how the, it's about, do you have written down in a Word document how your BNF should boot? Because that would suffice. Sometimes you discover that they don't. It's just trying an error. So they do not even have a workflow to start a BNF. That is something that needs to be addressed. And it's the source of many pain points, actually, in the onboarding of the BSN industry. We are not talking about languages. We are talking about simply an understanding of a procedure and going step by step. Okay, and that's it. So next step is that we plan in the joint demonstration to take a step forward and try to do an interconnection. Right now we have, of course, all the templates that I'm showing you can be exchanged, especially when it can be instantiated either in Telenor or in Telefonica, no matter what are the, by the way, we have different infrastructures, so it's the best test that we could do. I mean, that's working. The next step that we want to take is how to do, if we were running our own slices and we wanted to interconnect them, what, how would be that challenge? That's something that is not a trivial problem, it's also a market problem, but at least we want to assess what are the best options, technically speaking, to address that in the connection challenge. Okay? And that's, and of course, everything that I'm showing here is publicly available, so in case that you have any doubt, or of course I will be around, but only until lunchtime, but if you want to pause and ponder, et cetera, all the material is available, okay? And that's it. Any question?
So in your, and thank you very much, first of all, for the presentation. In your example, where do you get the inventory data from? Is that hard-coded, or where do you get the data?
In the inventory of?
You know, you want to provision from, orchestrate from A to B. You have to tell the system, you know, this is my starting point, this is my end point. Do you have an integration with in existing inventory system?
Well, actually, you don't need that. I mean, well, there's some step of pre-provisioning that obviously have not been shown. That is that I'm telling and instructing the system which accounts with which credential I have, what BIM targets I have. Okay, so that is, obviously, it's a step that you need to take.
Okay. I wasn't clear. So I'm talking about the referential integrity of the data. If you have a VNF and you have limited resources, let's say 1,000 CPUs on one side and 1,000 on the other side, and based on redundancy and everything else, backup, you need 480 on VNF, you know, for one instance, 480 for, mm-hmm. and 20% overlay. So this kind of instantiation of VNFs and CPUs, that's something which is not probably happening in your workflow, right? Is that correct?
No, it is.
So,
I mean, it's happening, of course.
No, the provisioning, I understand, but the actual inventory is saying, I have resources available.
No. I mean, it's not how a cloud works. I mean, what you do is that, done by a scheduler. I mean, when you are, there are two components there. I mean, one is that when you are selecting how to split an existing network service template at the time of the instantiation, that you can determine several tracks to distribute it, or where to, if you want to move it together to one location, that's fine. But ultimately, the owner of the catalog of resources is on BIM, and the BIM tells you exactly how it goes. So, in case that I'll give you an example. In case that one of these network subnets did not have enough resources to be launch, the BIM will report us, and then OSM will do a rollback. I mean, but that's not rocket science. It's simply...
You're saying we don't need OSS inventory, we don't need anything?
No, I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is that there are parts... I mean, this is taking aside the slicing discussion, sure. Okay? So, in a cloud architecture, you don't really need to know in every single layer every single detail of the resources. That is part of the beauty of having it layered. So you don't necessarily need to know at orchestration level the detail of the allocation of resources and the detail of the scheduling that is going in the beam. If you go to the beam via management, you can know what is going on, right? And that's totally captured there. And there are some databases that are very exhaustive on telling you where each component is and the resources that are available, etc. You can even query them via API. I mean, all that is there. And that information can be offloaded even to external databases and fed to somewhere else. I mean, if your question is all this under control? It's under control, okay? But, I mean, the good thing is that is already controlled by one layer, okay? So we are simply leveraging on that. In the same manner, for instance, they were launching some of the subnets to Amazon. We don't really know where they are, right? But still, we have an identifier, so we can keep interacting with them, and that is kept somewhere, okay? But in a public cloud, you have an equivalent way of knowing where your workloads are, and et cetera, and it's taken care entirely by the bin layer, okay? Unless you want to bypass the mechanism, okay? That is also possible, but not convenient, but possible.
From Francisco, my comments. Do you have any test for the, mainly slice at the same time for the testing, as any downgrade of performance?
I'm not sure if I've got the question.
You just gave a network slicing. It's only one slice, correct? But if 10 slices happens at the same time, is there any testing for that? That's multi-slice.
Any testing product?
Yeah, testing for any downgrade of performance.
Yeah, but okay, but I mean, I think that we are opening a different conversation. I mean, is that how SI can be done in a slice, okay? And I think it's an interesting problem. You need to some collaboration from the BNF itself and reporting some of the KPIs. That is doable, and actually in a framework like this, I'm not trying to show everything that is doable, but it's possible. But there's some... I would say that 90% of the heavy lifting happens in the BNF, okay? Because without the collaboration, at least with some monitoring with the BNF, it's really challenging to get reliable data for that. Okay.
So Francisco, at the end, you said that now you're trying to apply it to two slices that belong to your own network, right? But wouldn't that problem... Two parts that belong to Telefonica's network. Is that what I heard?
No. I'm saying. I'm not showing it, but maybe I could show it. No, maybe I was too fast in that slide. No, what I was saying is that what we are exploring together with Telenor is that there's some slide that can be shared across service providers.
Okay.
Now it's clear.
Okay, got it.
Okay, I was too fast. I'm sorry.
Thanks.
I have two short questions. The first is, in this setup, do it require any dedicated network slicing manager? Because what we are hearing from vendors is that, like if you have different vendors, each want to place its own network slicing manager and integrate with the NFU, right? This is the first question. Mm-hmm. And the second question is, okay. In the portal which you are showing, we don't see anything about the charms. So we assume every new VNF which will be connect, it requires some information model or charm. So it's if VNF provide me just the package, is there a programmable way to do
everything? I'll answer one by one. First, is in this demo, you don't need a dedicated slice manager. I mean, there is one mistake. I mean, the construct, as I've said, I've tried to be very precise on the distinction between a network slice and a network service for a reason. Because everything that I've not mentioned is exactly the same. So you simply need to take care whether you can reuse some pre-existing subnet or not. That is the only addition besides some structure and some standard that in the end is following a standard format, okay? There's no point, you can do that, if you want. You can put an independent slice manager standalone, but with the restriction that the slice manager is likely to be only for a single vendor. So if all your components come from the same vendor, fine. If you have different vendors, as in this demonstration, it's super challenging, okay? So there's no point, in this case, there's no point in having an external slice manager. You could do for the fine of it, but is not adding much value. And the second question, I think, is equally interesting because, procedurally speaking, as service provider, what you are getting is the package, which includes all the charms. I mean, you know more than you should know, to be honest, because you know the internals of the package. Congratulations. But the thing is that what you are getting is the package. That's it. And the package includes all the information that is needed. And there's some decomposition, et cetera, et cetera. But in the end of the day, we should demystify a lot of things in this industry. I mean, what comes in the package is just a description in a text, because otherwise, I mean, you can draw diagrams, right, of the topology of the components. That's it. And on the other hand, you have some running code that would be equivalent to the kind of testing that you would do in a CI/CD. That's it. Integrated in a manner that is convenient, is compact, is testable, etc., etc. But that's it. All that, there is a complexity that is happening in the development phase. What you receive is what you've seen. A service provider. That's what you are receiving, the package. Of course, you validate it, but you are not debugging inside the package. The package is a unique thing, okay, that comes together. And if there's anything wrong in the package, it needs to be fixed in the package as a whole, okay? So, and actually, they are signed, so you cannot change them, okay? So, unless that you have the key, okay? Okay, so, I mean, if you have questions, I'll be around in the break. So.